You can feel the heartbeat of the summer right now. It was scorching today, and they only missed it by 11 degrees. They said it'd be 89, and it was 100. But that's not the story. Something really extraordinary happened today. And I'll start out by narrating the second part of it. Okay, the second part of it. But before we do that, I want to notice that there's some new viewers, and welcome the new viewers here. We don't know what we're doing, but it's extraordinary, okay? And that's for sure. And then welcome. I'm really happy to see some of the old-time viewers are still with us and watching. That's really tremendous, because there are some really extraordinary beings, you know, watching this channel from time to time, no doubt about it, because they know something extraordinary is going to happen, for sure. And it seems to be happening. It seems to be happening. So, I'm a little bit off kilter today because something happened which threw me a little bit off kilter. I'm driving down the freeway, and suddenly at the wheel, I suddenly get this feeling like an out of body experience, almost like my sensation was that I was suddenly falling to my left and like gonna go upside and fall to the ground and turn over like this, just like I completely lost my equilibrium, you might say. But I was still driving, and I caught myself. I said, "What in the world just happened? I don't know what happened. Was I holding my breath? Did I almost pass out? Did I have an ear problem? I tried to clear my ears, make sure that." I had no warning, advance warning. I feel fine. Everything's great. It just suddenly, out of the blue, this happened. So I was really, really startled. So we're in rush hour traffic, what I thought to be rush hour traffic, really heavy. And so we're going real slow, which was good because my heart was pounding, and I was saying, you know, I don't understand what just happened. It's just like my psyche tended to just like fall down somehow and turn over, so to speak. So after a little while, we're going along the freeway pretty slowly, and then I see this black umbrella on the freeway, and I said, "Whoa, that's weird." And then I saw some debris and then some glass, and I said, "Uh-oh, looks like a fender bender, something happened." And then suddenly we crest this hill, and off to the right side was this car that had just gone through horrendous turnover. Just smashed and crushed. It was horrible to see. And then when I saw that, I said, "Oh my gosh." That somehow I knew that psychically I had reacted to what had happened there before physically I'd ever even got there and seen it. And no, I don't have GPS that tells me their accident, their smartphone, nothing. No heads up at all. And I say, "Well, I must have been like a mile to half a mile away when suddenly I felt this whole scenario of this extreme out of the blue turnover." And my spirit seemed to turn over like that. So how do you explain that? You know, how does anyone explain that? And I still feel unstable right now. It was shocking. Such a violent turnover. Okay, such a violent turnover. This doesn't, you know, I've always been extremely psychic in my life. And so this is just another one of thousands upon thousands of different experiences I've had, but it really is resonating, like, uh-oh. Now, but that's only the second part of the story. The first part was a dream I had. And I woke up with this dream bothering me, and it was a very simple dream. I went into this hardware store And I decided it was time to check out. So I went to the counter to check out. I don't remember having anything to buy in particular, actually. But it was just sort of time to get in line, then it was time to check out. So there's a cashier there. And as I got to the counter, this man came from kind of behind me. I don't know where he came from. And he came up to the cashier and said, he started talking to her. And so I said, oh, okay, he had some issue. He was talking about something. And she goes, huh? She's kind of struggling, like, what are you saying? And he's trying to explain to her. So I'm waiting there. And I say, okay, it should be ironed out soon. But it kept going on and going on and going on. And I kind of asked her, said, I'm here to check out. Are you, you know, what's going to be available to you? Oh, yeah, I'll be right with you. I just have to take care of this, you know. And so I couldn't exactly get the gist of their conversation. It was something about, like, he wanted to return. He was making some return. But she could not, you know, she was kind of saying, no, you got to have this, you got to have this, you got to do this. And he said, no, no. And so somehow he was able to keep her attention for so long. And finally I just said, man. You know, I'm just being ignored here. I can't check out. So I didn't know what to do. I woke up. I was kind of just sort of backed off a little bit and said, I got to say, what am I going to do? Stay here in the store? Okay. So it seems like a pretty innocuous dream, but I was really bothered by it. I said, what in the world is going on here? I said, that man, why didn't he see that and he wanted to check out? Why was he, you know, he was very intent and it was a very odd conversation. Obviously, this was not something normal at all. So, as I went through the day and I'm really focusing, I said, I got to focus on this, what's happened. It seemed extremely important to me. And finally, I admitted to myself that what it most likely was. And I said, why am I in this hardware store? And then suddenly say, it's time to check out. I didn't have anything. So what's going on here? And what it is check out means die. See, in our language, to check out, to checked out is a way of saying dying. And so I realized that it was my time to die. And so I said, I'm not really interested in this hardware store, I mean the body, hardware store, material realm. It's the material realm. So I was getting ready to check out of the material realm. It was my time. I've never felt that I was going to live to be long, an old age here. I never felt like I wanted to stay here. I'm not interested in this realm at this point. And so I just decided, well, it's my time to check out, and the cashier was supposed to check me out. You check in with a mother cashier, the mother cashier checks you out. It's a symbol for coming into the world and then leaving the world. Now, this man, I realized, was Longchenpa, the omniscient Dharma King Longchenpa. I've seen him quite a bit now in my life. And he was preventing my checkout for one thing. He has some return that's taking place. His return. He's returning to this world in some way, Longchenpa, and so he blocked my death. He prevented my death from happening because he wants me to help him, and I agreed to help him. So I'm. It's a very interesting situation I'm in now, where I should be dead, actually. I should be dead, but I'm not. So I don't know what to do. So you talk about amazing videos. This is one of them, right? You don't expect to hear this kind of stuff. So I told Longchenpa, sure. Anything I can do to help you, I'm willing. I'm in. But habit was that it's time to check out. My karma, habit, expectation was I was going to leave the world at this time. But Longchenpa checked the karma, checkmated the karma, so to speak, which he has the right to do since I agreed to it. And I was very surprised. Usually the cashier, a place like that, they'll tell the customer, what the rules are, et cetera, and the customer has to accept, this is how things are done. But this man would not do that. He insisted, no, I'm making this return. And that's what's going to happen. And the cashier, the I guess you might say the checkout girl, which is really death, which is really death, kept saying, well, we don't do it that way here. This is what I don't understand. What, this is a very unusual request. It wasn't normal at all. So there's something that Longchenpa is doing, which is way outside the boundaries of our expectations in terms of the overall karma pattern of this planet, actually. So I'm kind of excited about that. And this then later this turnover, this flip like this, really bad. There's a bunch of people that stopped there and were milling around, and I was like, wow. And I felt that before I even reached it. Isn't that something? So I felt the vibe of the accident. I felt the vibe of what happened. I felt the vibe of flipping over. I felt all that stuff before I ever even reached the accident. So what to make of all this? It makes a good video, doesn't it? So, and I've been practicing the new way all day, which is great, which is profound. And part of what we're doing is we're focusing on singularity practice. Okay, the new way really is singularity practice. It's really the key. It is really, really the key to your spiritual survival, so to speak, during these times. Now, so I don't identify with the younger generations at all. I don't identify with the way culture has gone. It seems very alien to me. And I'm really not interested in the world at all. So by all accounts, it was time to check out. But Longchenpa had other ideas. He most certainly did. So that means that the times are going to become very interesting for those who want them to be very interesting. And you may not know what you're going to do either. You see, this really alters something. Something's really been altered. Longchenpa is really altering something here. He's altering a pattern here. It's really quite extraordinary. We think of someone we don't know, like Longchenpa. We say, oh, just a person or something. No. Many refer to him as the second Buddha, okay? The second Buddha. And he's right there in that conversation, okay, with Gautama Buddha. He's right there. So don't underestimate, what he can do. But he's very low key. There's no ostentation about him. He looks like a middle-aged businessman, sort of. But he knows his business. He knows his business. And what is his business is the question. Well, I'll tell you, the Dharma is certainly his business. What he wants most for all of us is this. How can we even describe it, right? To recognize that nothing's ever been fixated, and that we're all instantaneous. Everything is instantaneous. And we're absolutely in the freedom of that perfect instantaneousness. And he's super dedicated to this. I mean, he's just like the heart of dedication, you would have to say. Some of these great Tibetan Buddhists, their dedication is something that we cannot really appreciate enough. These bodhisattvas. They really are like just absorbed in this dedication. It's a different vibe that I get, you know. He's on the battlefield, you know. I mean, he's here with us. He's taking on the challenge. So, for him to step right in and block my death like that, you know, that's a wow moment, to say the least. Now, I had some other troubles today that I had to overcome, to say the least. It was a very dangerous day, very difficult, dangerous day. Safety problems that I was able to fix, and other people didn't know how to fix them. I had to tow a trailer. The hitch, the nut on the hitch that held the ball on the hitch, was almost falling off when I got it, and nobody even knew that. But I caught that problem. It could have fallen off, you know, and the hitch would have been pulled free and would have lost control of the trailer. It was that loose. It was just completely pivoting there, that loose, and I caught that. I don't know how I caught that, because I normally would never. I don't deal with such things. I would not have paid attention to it. But I caught that. And then the brake lights didn't work on the trailer, and nobody could figure out how. And I finally fixed that by just inverting the whole thing. I inverted the plug. And the tail light, the brakes worked, but the turn signals didn't work. They weren't working before either. But at least I had the brake lights working. And then I used my arm for turn signals, and everybody, you know, it was easy. I was able to get, it was all fine. But nerve-wracking. So I was able to get brake lights when nobody could do that, and able to catch this problem with the hitch. People was about to become unhitched, you know. These are serious safety issues. And I was able to fix both of those. So I don't know what's going to happen at this point. And so it's very wowish, and I just have to practice singularity. You know, the future is wow, the past is wow, the now is wow. So I was practicing, everything is wow. Everything my mind tried to question was wow. It's a beautiful practice, a super powerful practice. So if we have some inkling of the times we live in, I would really most, you know, seriously suggest that you just start doing the singularity practice. Just as you're driving. Just have fun with it as you're driving along. Just do it. Don't ask why you're doing it. We're past asking why we do anything. You say, why am I doing it? Wow is why I'm doing it. And how is it? What kind of effect it's going to have? It's going to have a wow effect. How successful it'll be? It'll be wow. It'll be really wow. How long do I need to do it? I need to do it, wow long. So give answers, every question, give an answer in the wow form, you see, and you can do this while you're driving. So it feels as though this is really what's coming, this new way of practicing the singularity and encouraging those who are extraordinary to do this. This is really a you know, super technique, practice technique. And I would not fool around with anything else at this time. I really would not, and I'm certainly not. I'm really doing this new way, the singularity practice of a new way of wow. How is my practice going? It's going wow. You know? How do I feel about it? I feel wow. And you can practice, and you block all the dialogue, all the doubts, all the extrapolations, the concatenations, the complexities, everything. You block it. You just keep blocking it like this. You're like a jiu-jitsu master or something, you know. They make a move and you're Aikido, you're not there. You know, the ego like tries to punch you. And oh, you're over here now, what happened? You know, you're wow, where'd you go? You went to wow. So, you know, you don't want to be in a position where tremendous spiritual grace is suddenly being poured out and you don't know what to do about it. You do not want to be caught in that position. Singularity practice, you know exactly what to do, right? You say, I do wow. I know wow. I do wow. I am wow. All is wow. And even wow is wow, and even not wow is wow. You see? Wow is wow, and not wow is wow. Wow is wow, and not wow is wow. Now, it is granted, not many in the world are going to do this right now, perhaps. But if you're exceptional, then you need to be exceptional at this point. You need to take it out of theory into practice. Sagardana Maharaj talks about this, how he says what really succeeds, he says there's just one key, earnestness. He calls it earnestness. He says the merely clever, the merely curious and clever will never succeed. At this will never succeed. That will never succeed. They never can get past the doubts. Where earnestness goes beyond cleverness and curiosity. And earnestness actually does it. And that's what Maharaj did. He was earnest. And he just did it. With tremendous results. We don't need to be less than Maharaj. Not at all. He was just a simple cigarette salesman. Well, and then he had a little market or something. He was nobody. But he was very earnest. That's all. He was earnest enough to practice singularity practice. Okay? That's all it takes. That's all it takes. Is earnestness enough to just do it? And so when you're driving and you're thinking and you start recognizing the questions you're throwing at yourself. It's good to do this practice on the fly too. Really, really it is. And you just say, oh, okay, let me respond to that. I'm having this dialogue of questioning and things going on. And say, it's wow. And then throw the ego, you got its attention. It says, well, wait a minute, you guys, what about this? You know, you said the past is wow. What about the future? How's your future going to go? My future is already wow. It's going to be wow. It already is wow. Okay. So you start catching this inner dialogue and you jump in. Jump into your inner dialogue with wow. And start cleaning up the mess. You're saying, I have the answer to all this. I'm the one who's in charge. Not you, ego. Not this constant monkey mindness. No, I'm the one who's in charge. I know my being. My being is wow. I am wow. Abidance is wow. And non-abidance is wow. Okay? How is abidance? It's wow. How about non-abidance? Also wow. Okay? So no matter what, it's wow. You see, you just keep putting the ego through this. Changing your expectations of how you deal with this questioning aspect of yourself. We call it the ego. It's incessant. It's incessant. It tortures us, doesn't it? Man, there's no air moving at all right now. I mean, there is just not even a breath of air moving here. This stuck up. This the online weather is so terrible. It's extraordinarily bad. Makes you wonder. What else the internet's bad at, right? The scientists cannot predict a scorching day like this. I mean, this is a high pressure system. This is it. Did they just it came out of nowhere or something? I mean, come on. Everybody was talking about it. I said, this is, wow, what happened? This is so hot. Nobody expected it. So we're supposed to rely on these computer people to tell us what's going to happen in the world? Excuse me. I'll take my intuition over any of that, okay? I was aware of this accident before I even got to it. I realized something really, really significant had happened, and I reacted to it. The vibe, it's like an earthquake that sent out this, you know, something really, you know, I call it the turnover times, and it's coming. So my awareness of it was there before I even got to it physically. So I'll take that over, you know, all this computer models, right? Artificial intelligence trying to tell us, you know, what we should prepare for. Okay, do not place your faith in artificial intelligence telling you what to prepare for. Okay, you keep your faith in the mind, the one mind. And you pay attention to your synchronicities and what arises in your mind and the dreams that you have. You pay attention to all that. Don't pay attention to artificial intelligence these days, okay? And you might say, well, you know, I don't know what's going to happen. Exactly right. In terms of the grace of God, what is the grace of God going to do? And I just have faith that it's going to do something extraordinary. Don't know what it would be, but I feel game. I feel game enough to go along with it. And so all you have to do is feel game enough to go along with it and say, okay, I'm going to be part of the solution here instead of part of the problem. That's all. Well, I'm going to be part of the solution instead of part of the problem. Giving my back a rest today. Smart. Smart. See? Just say, yeah. Don't overdo it. Too hot to do anything today. Wonderful. Wonderful. Whew. Wow. Okay, so we let our attention settle here a little bit here as we go forward with this very extraordinary feeling right now. Very extraordinary feeling. And maybe you're feeling it too. Maybe you're feeling like, you know what? It feels like there's just something very significant is taking place now. When I have that dream where it's so important, the omniscient Dharma King steps in and blocks my leaving this world, blocks it. Delays it, certainly. Delays it. You know he has a purpose on his mind for that. That's an extremely significant, you know, action to take. Now, we're simpatico. Why? Because I place so much emphasis on trying to make put the right phrase and words and, you know, careful. I'm so into, like, composing, carefully composing expressions. That it really matters to me. It matters a lot. And of course, he is perhaps the most renowned in all of history for the ability to somehow make truth seem accessible to us, even though he used words. When you read what he says, you feel, oh, so that's it. You know, it just has this preeminent genius in that. So I'm very simpatico with that. For example, I don't like the word kingdom of heaven, okay? I do not like that term. It's very misleading. It's not a kingdom. A kingdom implies a king with subjects underneath that and a whole hierarchy of, you know, aristocracy and courtiers and all this kind of stuff. Heaven is the opposite of that. It's perfect equality. So why would you call it a kingdom? You see, it's perfect equality. So I wouldn't use that term. I wouldn't use it. So there's various terms that kind of cloud things more than you would like to have them clouded. And the whole thing about kingdom and kinship with the king is really what's wrong with the world, really, is the tribalism of believing that you have to get into some kingdom with a king that will protect you from your enemies, and you get special perks for being closely aligned, either with blood, you know, blood relations with the king, that you have some sort of in with the king, so you get more, and ultimately means you're protected from annihilation. This is the ego. That's the ego. So the ego would look at it as like a kingdom, kingdom of heaven. That's an egoic formulation. So when I read something, I'm very, very keen about, you know, what language is used, and what and Longchenpa's language is just so extraordinary in how he's able to pick the apt phrase, the apt way to say it. You know, it's like, you know, flawless, you might say. Flawless. And it's astonishment, you know, how he was able to do that. Because others have not been quite like that, you know. And the marvelous aspect of Longchenpa is we don't know. Especially in modern age and in the West, even more so, we just don't know, you know, what it is that we are being graced by. We don't know, which is kind of cool, isn't it? We've got this very open mind. I don't have preconceptions. I really don't. I don't know what he's going to do. I don't know what to expect. I don't really have expectations built up. And maybe that's a great advantage. Maybe we have a great advantage here in the West, actually, to tell you the truth. So I don't want anyone to sell themselves short. Don't shortchange yourself. You don't know. You may be in a very advantageous position because you don't have expectations. We have a lot of expectations about Jesus, don't we? And of course, those get in the way. And Jesus has made it very clear that those most certainly do get in the way. But Longchenpa, I don't have any expectations. I don't know what to expect. It's just nothing arises in terms of expectations. I keep getting surprised, I'll tell you that. Like, okay, he's doing this. Okay, wow, that's interesting. I guess we have general expectations of what a holy person is supposed to be like, et cetera, but he's never presented himself that to meet any of my expectations in that way. It just doesn't. So, but it can be a great disadvantage to have a lot of expectations around someone, because then you'd say, oh, okay, I already know what you're supposed to do, so I know it's going to follow what my expectations are about. And at that point, you kind of are following your ego at that point, and then you're ego tripping. But with Longchenpa, I don't know what he's going to do. I had no idea he could step in like that. Or do such a thing. I've never heard of such a thing. So I kind of like, it's shocking, but at the same time, I'm sort of like, well, you know, okay, it's okay. So that's what he can do. Okay, there's a little, I know a little bit now. I don't, but I really don't know any of the rest. And the rest could just go on, you know, indefinitely, right? I mean, we don't know. We don't know. But some again hold him in the highest esteem, the highest esteem from the Eastern traditions, the highest esteem. And they use terms like Buddha, you know, second Buddha, and teaching in a more profound way than even the first Buddha. First Buddha had his great mission to start Buddhism. So, as Longchenpa said, that he needed to speak in such a way that it would reach those he was speaking to, and begin, you know, get it all moving, which is tremendous, tremendous job. But he didn't speak that much about some issues. Didn't emphasize some issues. Where that Longchenpa tends to emphasize the higher, he most certainly emphasizes the higher, which is really non-duality. He emphasizes non-dual perspective, non-dual practice, non-dual dharma. He's all about that, all about that, and that's what we're all about also. So there's this wonderful synergy there, without expectations. Synergy without expectations. So whatever he does, we would say, okay, so that's what he does. I didn't know. Great advantage. Great advantage. If he showed up here, I would just, you know, just sit here and say, wow, okay, I don't know exactly what's going on. I don't know what to expect. Every time he appears in a dream, I say, who's that? I don't know who it is. And I said that. And later on, I say, hey, that was Longchenpa. I mean, what was he doing? He was. But I realized very important stuff. But so casual and so certain and. How he does it is just like, huh. Dharma kings are like that. There's not a shred of doubt, you see, in their mind. Not a shred of doubt. Their mind is absolutely this instantaneous, non-dual mind. And they're very incisive, decisive. They make their chess moves right at the right moment without any delay at all. I mean, they know what the chessboard's all about, what the moves the others are going to make, and at the right moment, boom, they just simply, easily just slide their, you know, knight, and like that, just like that. Very calmly, because they're sure they're going to win. You know, they're certain of it. So there's no, you get no feeling of trepidation, like, okay, hesitation, like, okay, should I move my knight now? Wait a minute, you know, should I move it there? No, it's just, the knight is moved like that. The bishop moves like that, you know, the rook moves, whatever it is, that moves like that. The pawns, and I haven't played chess in a long time. I know the king, the queen, the bishops, the knights, and the rooks, and then the pawns, something like that. But they just make their move like that. And it changes the whole chess match, doesn't it? Changes the entire chess match. So this is what's happened today. It seems like the entire chess match has suddenly changed. I thought I was pouring myself a root beer on a hot day like this. Turns out it was diet ginger beer. Diet ginger ale, essentially. Diet ginger beer. Which is fine. I think ginger on a real hot day like this is good. So it would be root beer. But diet's even better, I guess, right? I did have a big burger, veggie burger, on a hot day like this. It seems to be appropriate. Something about hot days and hamburgers. I don't know why it goes together. We associate summer with hamburgers and hot dogs and ice cream and root beer and watermelon and stuff like that here. It seems to go together nicely. Very, very warm day. So part of the excitement of these videos is that we don't know where we're going exactly, what is going to happen, but we certainly realize that we live in tumultuous times. And that car flipping over like that indicates very tumultuous times. Okay, very tumultuous times. But the wow practice say, how are the times? The times are wow. What is happening in the world? Wow is happening in the world. What is your feeling about what's happening in the world? My feeling about what's happening in the world is wow. My feeling about wow is wow. Are you for this or that? I'm wow about this. About that, I'm wow about that. I'm wow about both, and I'm wow about neither. I'm wow about this, I'm wow about that, I'm wow about both, and I'm wow about neither. I'm wowing my path, and I'm wowing my non-path. I feel wow about it. So it's a super great time to be practicing this. So again, don't wait, just get in the pool. I know it's a tough thing to get in the pool, because you think, wow, I may not get out of this pool for a while. Well, it becomes a habit. Get in the pool of wow. Float around and just practice wow. And you may think you're a simpleton. That's okay. Look what Longchenpa did for this simpleton. I'm an incredible simpleton. I'm just wow is all I am. You know, my opinions is wow. My thoughts, all my thoughts are wow. I just actually have only one thought, which is wow. Only one opinion, which is wow. I'm just a singularity. That's all there is to me. So I'm real close to being zero, you might say. Recognizing zeroness. I actually have zero importance. But we could say I have wow importance. I have wow importance. Getting to zero, let's let the Dharma kings deal with zero, okay? Let's just us get to just one. So, look what Longchenpa did for someone who has, you know, just wow importance, nothing else. So don't worry about being unimportant. In fact, you might want to make yourself a little more unimportant. What are you going to do about it? I'm going to do wow about it. What do you mean? What's wow? I mean wow. Well, what is wow? Wow is wow. Now, socially, if you say this, they'll think you're nuts. There was this young man today that was working somewhere, and he's mentally disturbed, to say the least. But if you just say this, wow, socially, people think you're far more mentally disturbed than he is. I realize that. Yet I'm functioning really well and everything, but you know, they say, what do you mean? But you could practice, like, you know, silently. As you're going about your day, as you're driving, you know, don't let your thoughts ramble. Jump in on the singularity practice. Now, it takes a bit of will to do this, for sure. I mean, I have to use will, and I was going through all these scenarios today. It's stupid scenarios. What am I doing? Let me just jump into the scenario right here and say, okay, what's going on? So I'll tell you the answer. The outcome of this scenario is wow. So all these unanswered questions that start bubbling up is wow, 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 and you start answering all this, and the whole thing dissolves. Okay, it all dissolves. All these scenarios dissolve, like clouds dissolving. It's kind of like using the light to dispel the darkness. The singularity practice, actually, or the light of the sun to dispel the clouds, the fog, the haze, whatever. The nice breeze to dispel the haze. The breeze of wow. The breeze of wow. It's singularity practice. Trust it. Have faith in it. It's what those who have really succeeded, it's how they succeeded. It's how they succeeded. It's how they succeeded. Okay. And they've said this much. They said as much. My trying as well. My non-trying as well. My relaxing as well. My non-relaxing as well. See, this is actually practicing instead of taking a position. You see? So the clever, the merely clever, they take very clever positions. They can take a clever position on Dzogchen, okay? And many have. But we're more earnest than that. We're actually practicing. So my position on Dzogchen is wow, okay? My position on Longchenpa is wow. My understanding of Dzogchen is wow. I don't have a position. I have wow. My position is wow. I have a position. Yeah, I do have a position. It's wow. So this is genuine earnestness leads us to practicing the singularity instead of taking a very clever position on Dzogchen about, well, we need to relax and we need to not do anything and the non-doing, you know, and like that. That's taking a position. A definition in a way, some ways. It's a position. What we're doing is we're admitting to just one position. It's wow. My position is wow. My position on this is wow. My position on other teachings is wow. I didn't say it's the same or different. I said it's wow. So this is the wow of Dzogchen, actually, which is the actual practicing of a singularity as it applies in every direction, 360 degree direction, like this. Don't make any exceptions. Now, I believe this is what the gurus, the Dharma kings, look for, is do you have that earnestness to do that? And it hasn't been easy to come by it, I'll tell you that. Because there's so many clever positions out in this world, isn't there, about everything. And it seems so much safer to adopt a clever position on something and position yourself in a clever way. Because you know that you get accolades from that, except you also please the ego. And you don't have to deal with this feeling of existential threat by not pleasing the ego, you see. So it seems like you have your cake and eat it too. You get adulation, people think you're enlightened, or very a sage of some type. But the ego is also patting you on the back and saying, great, I'll make you famous, this is wonderful. You've been able to please, you've pleased both God and the ego. See, you're even greater than the others. Okay, that's goes to the very clever. But to the earnest, they're just actually practicing this very lowly importance as far as their mind goes. They're not taking really a clever position at all. They're simpler than that. There's some people who think they're crazy, you know, not clever. The clever look down on this and say, that's just absurd what you're doing. You know, there's nothing there. You know, nothing there. Nothing for the clever, that's for sure. Because they can't help but expound upon their cleverness, you know, and keep taking positions and position. Here, you know, we do it, they even take the position of saying they have no position. Here, we admit to a position, and that position is wow. Whereas the clever don't want to practice, they don't want to do that, because the ego doesn't like that, so they will take a position of a non-dual position, of like, well, I don't have any position at all. There is no I. I don't have any position. You know, but that's not practicing. That's taking a clever position, and that won't get the job done. But very tempting, right? Very tempting. There isn't this existential shock that you have to go through. I know there are mosquitoes out here because I got bit last night, so oh, they're going to get me again. But it's too hot to wear a long sleeve, kind of. So yeah, I do have a position, and my position is wow. And then the clever will say, well, you can't really abide with a position. You need to not have a position in order to abide. Oh, I say, well, my abidance is wow, and my not abidance is wow. And my feeling about that is wow. And my understanding about it is wow. And my position on all of this is wow. So this is deeply disturbing to the ego. It you know, to our expectations. We don't know what to do about it. We say, wow, I know what to do about it. Yeah, any problem, wow, is what I do about it. And so this reassures us. We say, oh yeah, I do know what to do about it. Wow is what I do about it. Practice the singularity. Don't think about it. Don't take a position on it. Don't say, oh, I see why that's important. Oh, I see this. Yeah, and then it's formulating a position on it. Say that, well, I see that it's wow. I see that it's wow. And it's wow now, and it's wow in the past, and it's wow in the future. And everything is wow, and nothing is wow. Wow is wow. So this is super practice technique, and anything less right now would be quite uncivilized, actually. We do not want to go down with the ship, okay? We're not about going down with the ship. It's possible the ship of civilization is about to really go down. We're not going down with that ship. We're going to maintain civilization, the torch of civilization, and really the light of civilization really is wisdom. The wisdom to recognize that this so-called human situation is such that we can turn it towards singularity practice and recognize that we've never been unawake at all. We've never been unawake. We've never been fixated. It was all just a play of our attention that was tricking ourselves, so to speak, pretending, a great play of pretending. And that's really what civilization here is about, because if we don't have that, then we have something else. And we're about to experience the world, what that something else is, and it's not pretty. That car that caught me on a shot. There was no signs. There was no police, no firemen, no cones, nothing. So it must have just happened. There was no emergency vehicles on the scene at all. Which is very surprising. Because we've been backed up or slow for quite some time. How is it possible that they didn't get, you know, emergency vehicles out there? I don't know. Because all the debris was still in the road. No, you know, no lanes were cut off, shut down, anything. It happened just out of the blue so quick that the response was so slow that normally I don't even look at an accident or anything, because I know if you see that there's some cones and an accident, okay, I just don't pay attention. This time I didn't have any idea there was an accident, so I was just saying, what's going on, that's not, then there was the car. Holy cow, the car was in this just terrible condition, you know, like civilization crushed. That's the direction. If you don't follow the Dharma, which is genuine civilization, you find that implosion happens. And it's happened over and over and over and over again throughout history, hasn't it? If you're a student of history, you look at the world history, you say, wow, what goes on? We start building, they start to build something up, and then you tear it down, build something up, because, you know, implodes, build it up, implodes. Whereas the dharmic cultures, they seem to continue on, and there seems to be light there. You know, there seems to be light there. But where the Dharma does not flourish, there's these implosions that happen. And you know, Europe has certainly experienced those, hasn't it? There are places in the world where they've certainly experienced it, and in recent, the 20th century was the, you know, most violent century in history. Unbelievable, right? The amount of warfare in the 20th century. In the 19th century, in America, we had the Civil War, which was unbelievably violent. You know, I don't know, what was it? You know, battles where huge numbers of people lost their lives there in battle. Just one battle. I don't know how many, but it was massive. Shocking, shocking numbers. Wholesale, you know, wholesale slaughter. It was an incredibly violent conflict in the United States. We think, oh, no, we've had any troubles here. Oh, yes, we did. We went through a severe implosion in 1861 to 65. It's interesting how the wars last like 4 years. World War I, I think, and World War II both lasted kind of pretty much, well, I think maybe World War II a little longer. The Pacific War lasted 4 years for us, but in Europe it lasted, you know, longer than that, I would think. But that's been going on all over the world, actually. Implosions have been happening in the 20th century. And now we're in the 21st century. And there have been a number of implosions already. So a non-dharmic culture lives for implosions, actually. They live for it. If you want to really tell the truth about it, and we should. And this is what I've noticed here. I've noticed the influx of a non-dharmic attitude in the world. I've been monitoring it my whole life. And I see these attitudes coming in, identifying with bodies. It's not the body's fault. It's the spiritual habits and attitudes that are coming in and their play of attention with the body here, using the body to camouflage what they're up to, actually. Blame the body, you know, blame the body. And these people, they love implosion. They love the violence. They love the implosion. And you realize that superficially, they're good citizens, so to speak. But underneath that, the kind of entertainment and symbols and graphics and all of that, everything they're drawn to, is the deeper mind is in severe conflict and loves implosion, loves implosion. So addicted to it. They got it tattooed all over themselves, you know, they just can't hide it. But superficially they'll smile and have a nice day, yeah, yeah. But that's just really super, very, very superficial. And it's amazing, you know, the talk they come up with, it's just, it's all about, you know, implosion, really. The sicknesses, the troubles, the deaths, the da-da-da-da-da. It's interesting, someone, relative of mine, was talking at dinner recently about someone they know, a good friend that works for them, their car just turned over, and they're, like, in severe trouble, extremely injured, fighting for their life in a lot of ways. Everything's gone wrong for them, terribly wrong, since that turnover. My cousin, about a year ago, died in a turnover. She was super rich and influential, but her Suburban rolled over, went off the road into a ditch, and rolled over really badly, front to back also, and she died from that. So suddenly there's all these turnover events that are coming to my attention. That's a very, very violent implosion. I've talked to so many people about turnovers, and they say it's the worst. It's the worst. It's the worst. Oftentimes, airbags are not activated in such a situation. So when you really flip and turn over and start, and the car's flipping end over end and just rolling and everything, that's the most violent type of situation possible, really, in a car. Even a head-on collision is not as violent in a lot of ways. You got the airbags will deploy certainly there. The car's meant to crumple really nicely these days. But the turnover, it throws you around inside the car so severely. You think the seatbelts hold you, they don't. And you bang your head on the window side, you're banging your head all over the place. So it's extremely violent activity, turnovers. So we're headed into the turnover times, which is likely, of course, going to be extremely violent because of the attitudes of everyone in this world. So many, deep down, they love implosion. Why? Okay, so you might say, why? Well, we know why. Because that seems to give them safety. It seems to say that they know how to unfix the mind. So it gives it the sense of feeling like they're in control of the mind. Okay, they're in control of the mind. It gives them a feeling of control, actually. But it's a delusional control. Because what they're really doing is telling themselves they're greater than God. And this, to them, is safety. Because they don't have to then give up this whole thing and return to realizing a perfect equality in reality, which is crossing what they feel is an abyss. Okay, we've talked a lot about that because they're dishonest about what happened. They think that fixating the mind is saved reality and it's a new reality, and so to give up fixation of the mind, they think, is to give up reality, which would be an abyss. But the only way they can really feel like there's fixation is to unfixate, because since there really is no fixation at all, we have to go through the song and dance of pretending there is by unfixating, which proves something must have been fixated in the first place. It's kind of like this. It's there by indirect proof, so to speak. Say, well, I died, so I must have been alive. That kind of thing, right? I got sick, so I must have been well. There must have been some fixated state because I radically changed it, you see. So I'm no longer in that state. So it infers fixation, sort of. Psychologically infers it. And this gives the ego this egoic feeling of the ego is safe from an abyss. So that's why so many love implosion. Someone asked me, did you see the 4th of July? Did you? How was it? Everybody asked me. I said, I didn't do anything. I just worked on spiritual efforts, singularity practice and ate too much food. But you didn't see the fireworks, you didn't do this. I said, you know what? I lost interest in fireworks a long time ago. I really have no interest anymore. Pretty interesting. And they were quite shocked. Someone said, I hope it never happens to me. And I said, oh, you'll be surprised. I'm happy that it's happened. Really. And you might say, I've lost interest in implosion also. Implosion is an interesting term, right? We haven't used that term before. We've talked about like the Titanic sinking, but implosion infers something that, wow, yeah, civilization just imploding. Civilization, the ization of civility. Get that. The overall, like we say, standardization. Ization means the overall scene of something, the totality of it, the totality of civilness. You put the overall civilness, all the civilness, and you have civilization. We all treat one another with civility, which is very, equality. You try to treat people equally and kindly, loving. Buddhism might call it loving kindness. We can just say kindness, or this feeling of mutual regard and respect, and feeling that you're You know, your spirit, just like me, we're equal in spirit. Despite seeming differences, we're equal in spirit. So I, you know, we try to be that way and not take advantage of anyone. There are opportunities to take advantage. We think, we say, no. You know, let's live and let live. And I mind my business, you mind your business, that's okay. I trust you, I respect you. This feeling of mutual trust is very important for civilization. We trust one another. You know, we follow the Ten Commandments. You know, we trust one another to follow the Ten Commandments and not be vicious and taking advantage of all this kind of stuff. And it's civilization, and civilization is really, it's dharmic, really. It has to be, right? It's built on the faith in a higher power that is going to, that can work in our lives and redeem us in some way, we free us from our regrets. You know, we're full of these deep concerns and regrets, and something in deep inside is really bothering us. And of course, we've brought that to light, what the whole complex is all about. It really bothers us all. And so the feeling like there's somehow that there's help in getting free of what really is troubling us. And so we have faith in that. And because we have faith in that, we have faith in one another. But when you're not dharmic, you don't have that kind of faith. You have faith in implosion, which is the ego. You have faith in the ego. And you feel the way to safety is to prove that you have the power to fixate the mind. And the way to prove you have power to fixate the mind is that you unfixate it. You believe you can, by unfixating it, you have proved that you fixated it in the first place. So the ego is the realm of death, okay? It's the realm of death, sickness, destruction, death, implosion. And the world is unfortunately populated by those who have this great love of implosion. Look at all the video games they look at. I've never played a video game, except for like about 1 minute, some car rally thing or something at a relative's house. And if I played it just like for 1 minute, I said, okay. And that's the only time I've ever played a video game in my life. I stay away from that stuff. It's not civilized, really. It's not what I see as civilization. Civilization is built on what we call respect for life. You don't bring up themes, you know. You don't play violent video games, for instance. You don't play games of seduction and glamour and stuff like that. That's disrespectful. It's trying to get an advantage, you know, in ways that's very non-dharmic. So the present culture of the world is extremely non-dharmic, actually. And if you're non-dharmic, your faith is in implosion, okay? Your faith is in the ego, and the ego's faith is in implosion, meaning its faith is in death, which death is just merely our attempt to prove that there was something that was fixated, the mind was fixated, which we call life, and that you undid the fixation. So you're showing your power over the mind. You can both fixate and unfixate, but unfixating proves the mind was fixated. You see that? Because the mind doesn't really quite feel fixated to us, does it, actually? And so we feel insecure, but if we die, we think that is going to be the proof. So we look at death as the ultimate proof. Really, the ego looks at death as salvation, which proves, the ego says, oh yeah, I indeed do have the power to fixate the mind, because I just unfixated it, right? That's showing a power there, isn't it? And it's saying that the fixation was there, meaning God is not all-powerful, because God created mind perfectly free. So the ego says that it's greater than God. It just, the ego just means our attempt to be greater than God. So Longchenpa is like a wild card in all of this, right? So we have this wild card in the deck. You know, or we don't know where he's going to show up next. We shuffle the deck and deal the hand, and we turn over the cards, and we wonder, what kind of hand am I going to have? And then suddenly, there's the wild card in my hand. I have a wild card in my hand. It's like, wow. In Tibetan, well, we won't get into that because that'll sort of attenuate our attention, actually. We have to pay attention to our attention here, and it's very keenly focused right now. So many turnovers in the Bay Area that I have driven past. So many turnovers, drastic turnovers. You know what? I went most of my life with never seeing a turnover ever. But this influx of these people in the Bay Area now, the tech people, so many turnovers. You hear about it so often now. They're driving like maniacs. Okay, there's a mentality that leads to turnovers, right? There most certainly is. And these people, the people who make these video games, a lot of them, right? San Francisco is a hub for that. That is for sure. It may be the world center for video games, San Francisco. These super violent, unbelievably implosion-based video games come out of San Francisco. And Silicon Valley, but a lot of that gaming is up in San Francisco. San Francisco is notorious for being a non-dharmic place, actually. Very notorious for being a hub of the ego perspective. And, by extension, being very clever about taking positions on spirituality as well. But not so much known for any practicing, super earnestness of practicing, you see. Boy, turnovers are becoming very common here now. Very common. And the people, I think they're just accepting it. Like, oh yeah, there's another turnover. Are you kidding me? That should not be happening. I mean, we have always driven, been taught to drive with everyone else's safety in mind. Not just our own safety, everyone else's safety, and putting their safety on an equal level with our safety. That's called civilization. And when everyone feels that way, guess what? There's a lot of safety involved, right? I'm looking out for all of you, and all of you are looking out for me and everyone else, and we smile at one another. We're not trying to endanger one another by our driving in any way. It is unthinkable to try to endanger someone with our driving. But these people here now, they're heedless about endangering other drivers. It never even enters their mind. Everyone is just saying, I'm going to drive in whatever way I can get an advantage. And I see so much endangerment happening on the road. And it's just common. So this is extremely uncivil behavior. Very non-dharmic behavior here. So keep in mind, the ego's goal is implosion. It always has been, always will be. But the ego's very strong. The ego's frantically working on implosion. But first, it has to build something up to implode. Okay, it loves implosion so much that it frantically builds up structure, builds up something, so that it can implode it. So we think the ego is it's very helpful. It's so industrious. It's building all this stuff, building all this stuff up. But it's compulsive, isn't it? It's done in a very rapid, compulsive. I got to do this. Got to get this done, and all this. That's the activity of a maniac. Who says I love implosion and destruction so much that I'm frantic to build something up so I can tear it down. Whereas the dharmic culture doesn't have that franticness of having to build up structures. In fact, we really have almost zero interest in structure, building any sort of structure at all. Like I always say, I don't know how to make anything, actually. I just have no interest in you know, building up structure, because I have no interest in imploding structure, really, very little. Whereas the ego loves to build up structure. But does it love quote-unquote structure? I mean, appearances of pretend fixation. But the love that the ego is showing there is the love that it has of imploding the structure, so-called structure, to prove that it's greater than God. To the ego, that's proof. And the ego screams that we have to accept that proof. And how come there's something wrong with us if we don't accept that proof? The ego says, I've done so much implosion throughout the ages and you still don't accept it. You know, there's something wrong with you. Well, there's something wrong with the premise that spirit is holding for sure, about the premise about hallucination. Did spirit says that it hallucinated, went into hallucination in order to preserve reality, because reality is somehow imploded. And it's now spirit that God imploded, and spirit now is the new prime creator. But it's hallucinating all this, actually. But it says that we have to stabilize hallucination, which means we have to fixate the mind. So we're frantically trying to prove that we can fixate the mind. But the truth is, we hallucinated because we wanted to be greater than God. And so we hallucinated in the absence of reality. We hallucinated an implosion of reality that never took place. That never took place. That never took place. So when we stop hallucinating, there's no abyss there. There's perfect fullness. Everything is the heart of everything. So there's nothing to be afraid of in that regard. But the ego thinks that reality imploded and the mind hallucinated as the basis, the creation of a new reality of fixation, mind fixating all this so-called structure, we think. And yet it's really not fixated at all. We're pretending it's fixated. And so we pretend to unfixate it to try and give credence to the fact that it was fixated in the first place, you see? That what else can we do? We're trying to somehow fixate the mind and using the power of death, what we think is a power, to prove to the what we think is the cause, which is hallucination, to prove that the hallucination has the power to fixate, because we couldn't have unfixated if it wasn't fixated in the first place. So ego really worships death as salvation, as a gift to give to God, which is hallucination. The egoic God is just hallucination, the mind hallucinating, and we want to feed this idol, death to show, look, you did fixate something, and the proof is that it died. It was unfixated. And this is the horrible nature of conditioned existence, what the Buddhists call conditioned existence. It's just ceaseless death and decay, isn't it? Everything being built up so that it can die and seem to be unfixated, to implode. That's the very nature of this pretense we're engaged in, this egoic pretense. Trying to convince hallucination that it really is the new prime creator. Which is really trying to convince the mind that hallucination was necessary, and this is a new mind trying to convince itself, and to then realize, wow, there's nothing to go back to. I've got to fixate hallucination. Of course, the mind being free can drop any hallucination instantly. And that's what mind is afraid of. He says, oh my gosh, I feel I have the power to drop hallucination instantly. And that would mean annihilation, because reality imploded. So I've got to find some way to fixate the mind. But the mind says, I just can't seem to get the conviction that I can fixate anything. You know, I just don't have that conviction. But death is its attempt to gain this conviction. It's saying, well, I don't feel like... don't have the conviction that I fixate anything, but if I see it die, that should, hopefully that'll convince me that it was fixated. That means I must have that power, you know. It's trying to convince itself it has this power of fixation by using death, what we call death. But really the truth is nothing's ever died. Nothing's ever been born, and nothing's ever died. Meaning the mind has never fixated itself in any way. Therefore, how can it unfixate itself in any way? It's never been fixated. That's non-dual truth. Well, we reached the bottom of the ginger ale, kind of. you need something on a night like this. Man, is it? Good thing it's not really humid, or it would be really something. Talked to a man today, and he was here's another thing. Oh, talk about implosion is amazing. I met this man. He was helping me out with something, and I was working at this store, and I mentioned something about something. He said, "Well, where are you going? What are your plans for the weekend?" I said, "I got no plans really. I mean, I really, you know, I'm not able to." Or talk about somebody else that went to Tahoe. They just come back from Lake Tahoe, which he said was gorgeous up there. And actually, he came back and he was just really down in the dumps. And I said, "What's going on?" And people said, "Well, you know, he just came back from Tahoe and he's having a hard time." I said, "How is it?" He said, "It's like coming back to hell. Are you kidding me? I hated coming back here." He says, "Just hated it." And he was like really depressed. Because I said, "How was Tahoe?" He said, "Oh my God." He said, "It was so beautiful. I've only been to Tahoe like once or twice when I was young. I've never been back. And it's a playground of the rich, basically. I just don't resonate with the place." But he showed me some pictures. I mean, he loved it. He has a boat. Takes it out. You know, he's really good with boats and fishing and everything. And yeah, it's really green up there. It's just, I guess it's, the lake is totally full. Holds how many? Like 40 trillion gallons or something. And it's, the water's so clear and just green and beautiful and sparkling. And it's just lovely up there, you know, apparently. But of course, there's so many, many people. It's very non-dharmic up there in a lot of ways, actually. South Shore's got all these gambling casinos. It's a non-dharmic place, okay? So I don't go there. But he was really, really despondent of having come back to the Bay Area. But he's going back up there again next week. Someone's comping him up there, his family or something. And so he's getting to play golf up there and stay up there again. So he's looking forward to that. But it just shows you what a dismal place this is to come back to, actually. And I know the feeling when I got away from last month, month of May. Coming back here, I almost felt like I'd rather die than come back here. I mean, that's how I felt. I said, "No, let me just die." I said, "God, I don't want to go back to the Bay Area. I really don't. That's how bad it is here." So we were talking about that. I said, "Well, I don't, you know, can't afford to go up to Tahoe and do all that stuff." He goes, yeah, well, you can always win the lottery." And I turned to him, I said, I don't want to win the lottery." He says, I don't want to win because that'll really mess up my life. So I'm happy the way I am. I said, "I wouldn't trade my life with anybody. I mean, I don't have much at all, but I have a simple life. And I wouldn't trade with anybody." He said, "Yeah, I know what you mean. I'm the same way. I feel that way. You know, our life is what it is, and we have to really love our life. And don't get this idea you want to trade your life with someone else's life." And he said, "You know, he has a close relative that won $1.5 million in the lottery recently. $1.5 million. And he said, "It's all gone. It's all gone." He says, and then he started explaining to me what happens. And I know I've heard this before. And he says, the people don't realize. They buy a house, they buy a car, they buy this. He says, all the payments, all the insurance, all the upkeep, all of this, all of that. And before you know it, they're wiped out. Wiped out. And they're, you know, they didn't have money to start with, so they don't know how to manage the money. They don't know how to invest it, he says. And then he said, also said his friend won like $300,000 recently, and he bought a boat, he bought a motorcycle, he bought all these toys, and then he ended up having to pawn all of them after a short time. He went broke and had to pawn all of his new toys and possessions, you know, took a massive beating on Adada. Now he's back, says, working like a dog again. And I said, you see, I said, look, the most important thing in life is peace of mind. You know, if you don't have that, all the money in the world is, you know, you always want more and more and more and more power, power, power. And you want to align yourself with the king to get that power. So you want the kingship, the tribal kinship with a king, a powerful king. So you can think you can be in the kingdom of heaven with this powerful king that you're aligned with, and you get more and more and more and more and more to try and treat this feeling of not enough. Well, the not enough feeling comes from the mind feeling it hasn't got enough power to fixate the mind, and the fear of the abyss because of this. So that's why the rich always want more. You talk to anybody who's had experience and they say it's true. Talk to another friend, he said the same thing, that it's never enough for them. It is never enough. And I know a lot of wealthy people, and it's never enough. You know, it's never enough. Some are more gracious than others, but it's still never enough. They always buying more, gotta get this new thing, gotta get this, gotta go here, they don't have peace of mind. They have great wine, but they don't have peace of mind. So they can show you their wine cellar, you know, $1,200 bottles of wine, and say, let's get peace of mind by drinking this wine. They have a really nice, great, you know, expensive meal, and then this really super expensive wine, and this is the, for them, that's the pinnacle of life, you know. And of course, it's never enough, is it? They're ignorant of the Dharma. They're really ignorant of it. They're ignorant of right practice. They're ignorant of the singularity practice. Totally ignorant of it. Like, it never ever crossed their mind. You know, that's how ignorant. You know, coming into this world and being ignorant of the Dharma is like saying you're like ignorant of your breathing. I mean, you don't even know about breathing. You're completely breathing. What's that? I have no idea what breathing is. Well, Dharma is more important than breathing. So to say you're ignorant of the Dharma is say that you're ignorant of something more important to you than breathing. More important than eating. More important than sleeping. How can anyone be ignorant of the Dharma? It's just, you know, it's stupendously foolish, actually. Severe grandiosity of, driven by a fear of annihilation. Only the fear of mind's fear of being annihilated could possibly bring about this ignorance. And indeed, that's exactly what's causing it, what's bringing it about. So the Dharma has this difficult task, you know, to explain. I explain, but you can't make anyone listen. You can't make anyone listen that doesn't want to listen. So what happened with these people that won the lottery was they imploded. They built it up, and then their lives imploded, you see. The news is full of implosions, right? That's all the news is these days, is who's imploding, right? And, you know, you have to love that stuff in order to pay attention to it. And I hate it. So I hate the news. I hate newspapers, the news, any of that. I don't watch it. I boycott it. I absolutely boycott it. But those who watch it, they have to love it to watch it. They have to think that's their salvation to watch it. They have to, right? And we know that that's exactly what's going on. That the ego believes that implosion is the salvation mind's looking for. So the ego, being a servant of the mind, so to speak, it's just mind's desire. It is what it is. The ego, you know, is the mind is pushing this. Implosion is so important. They say implosion's all important. That's what'll save me. No, it won't. The mind doesn't need any salvation, really, except to honestly look and see that it's totally safe. Nothing can happen to the mind. If nothing can happen to the mind, what is salvation except to see this fact, right? And the singularity practice helps us greatly see this fact. That's all that has to happen, a simple insight to see this fact. Nothing can happen to the mind at all. It's perfectly safe. It's just seeing this fact, and that's the end of all this this desire for implosion, this feeling that implosion has some relevance, you know. We don't have to keep dreaming the dream of implosion. and cleverly rationalizing it all. There's so much clever rationalization in the world about it. I always saw through that, which may be kind of persona non grata in the circles of cleverness. I've never been welcome in the circles of cleverness. I mean, golfers will let me play golf with them. You know, this guy's smoking a cigar, big cigar. Hey, where you from? Oh, great, okay. And, you know, just a, you know, kind of an athlete, hail fellow, just, you know, not feeling too important about himself or anything like that. Say, oh, come play golf with us. That's okay. We'll let you do that. But other than that, you know, the clever won't allow me near them, really. Because they're very insecure and need to be reassured that they're right. Because they're really worried, like, holy cow, what happens if this doesn't work? I don't have any fallback position. Man, this is scary. So the clever choose clever leaders, of course. Who can set up really, really clever implosions. See, these days, we're the world's really, they're aiming for very clever implosions. You know, they think that that's more effective than more, you know, they don't really like the knights jousting anymore, that kind of thing. They want stealth implosions. They want all sorts of, there's war for all the different styles of implosions now are different. Chivalry is dead among these folks. They want treacherous, devious, sneaky implosions, but all possible. They say, well, the other step didn't work, you know, it didn't quite work, so we want a different style of implosion. Or it could just be very massive, very quick, you know, very shocking. But we're always trying, the clever are always trying different styles of implosion. So they've built up this massive pyramid here to be imploded in this world right now. It's obvious. They're not really lovers of civilization. Not at all. They're lovers of implosion, and you will find that out. So we, being lovers of civilization in terms of really civilizations built on the Dharma, actually built on getting away from implosion, to lose, you know, letting go of our love of implosion, because we see that it's not necessary. We're not threatened with annihilation, actually. We're not threatened with annihilation. We don't need kinship with some powerful king to save us from annihilation. As if we have blood relationship with a king, that we'll be saved, and if we don't, we'll be annihilated. That's, you know, that's egoic reasoning, or logic, egoic logic, false logic. We're not looking for any blood relationship with anyone, or any special relationship with anyone. We don't need it. The mind is not threatened in any way. The mind hallucinated to be greater than God, but it can't be greater than God. So nothing's changed about reality. It's still perfect. So you might ask yourself, what can Longchenpa do? You see, this is something worth asking yourself. What can this... You may know nothing about Longchenpa, but he has the grace and compassion of a Buddha. So what can a Buddha do, so to speak, right? What can a genuine Buddha do? Not someone who has a clever position about Buddha, but a genuine Buddha. What can a genuine Buddha do, actually? See, this is something that we don't know. We don't know what to expect. Not to mention all the other Dharma kings doing their thing, too. But I have seen that Longchenpa jumps in the pool. He jumps in, both feet. He doesn't. He's someone that takes action. It's very, very compelling to see that, to experience that. There must be tremendous faith, you know, in the power of compassion to do that. There has to be a tremendous clear vision in order to see compassion. And he speaks of that in his writings. Seeing that the ultimate nature, is part of its ultimate nature, is compassion. And the rays of compassion, he says, are always radiating in unlimited amounts everywhere. And the nature is to act in this compassionate way. The play of compassion is what a true bodhisattva is doing. So he says there's this massive play of compassion always taking place for us, for those, you know, trapped in this delusion of samsaric conditioned existence. And that's what he says, that's what happens when you're truly a Buddha mind. You realize all is Buddha mind. This is what happens just spontaneously, he says. You know, so he's just that spontaneous outpouring of compassion, of what we would say God, what they would say the Dharmakaya or Samantabhadra, the Dharmakaya. It's just, so it's just waves, you know, outpouring of compassion is reaching us. And we don't know what it's going to do, really. And we don't need to formulate too many ideas about it. I try not to figure it out at all. I just wow it, you know, just keep practicing. And pay attention. When he said, flatten yourself, get down, flatten yourself. I said, okay, let's do that. Let me see if I can do that. Don't take a position. Don't be seen as taking a position. He says, you'll be gunned down, you know. They're trying to implode everything here. The mood of implosion is upon this world. And so if they see that you're standing up as a position, they will absolutely implode it. So here, we're practicing the singularity practice. Yeah, we have a position. It's wow. But it's a totally flat position. So what he told me was take a flat position. This is Longchenpa appeared in a dream on the battlefield of what's happening in this world. And he shouted, he was shouting orders. He shouted at me. He says, get down, get low, flatten yourself. Very urgent. Boy, he caught my attention. He's like a general on the field of battle. You know, he was right in the middle, like a, you know, commanding officer with the group, right in the middle of all the action, shouting orders. You know, do this, do this, do this. You know, he's just right. You know, he's not some removed from it. He's in the both feet, boots on the ground with Longchenpa. It's boots on the ground. That's an attention getter, I'll tell you that. And so, and also, when Jesus came back and said, I'm back and I'm here just as your friend, that's it. Okay, there's no king here, no blood kinship, none of that tribal stuff. I'm just your friend, an equal friend to walk with you, beside you. And he said, who wants to accept that offer? Who? And I finally raised my hand and said, okay. And then what happened was we both got down on the ground. Jesus started getting down on the ground, and I said, wow, I got to too. I'm not better and higher than you, Jesus, come on. And he flattened himself on the ground. I flattened myself on the ground, and then we had a conversation. We're both flattened on the ground. So really what he was showing me is you need to flatten your self-importance. You need to flatten your position here. And this is the new way practice that he brought in June 4th this year, of the wow practice, of flatten your position. Yeah, I have a position. It's wow. But it's just wow. So it's like totally flat. Your position's totally flat. And that way, you cannot be imploded. Okay, there's nothing to implode. This is truly the time of implosion. If you look at that video, Longchenpa's Song of the Enchanted Wildwood, it's very clearly spelled out there of what these times are. It's a time when people turn away from the Dharma. And Longchenpa knew about these times perfectly. I mean, he coined that back in what? The 1400s, I guess? 1350 or something, maybe he wrote that or something. 1350. You know, it's like 600 and plus years later. And you'd swear he coined it for these times right now. You'd swear. This is someone living in these times writing this. When I first was read it, I started going over it. I said, wait a minute. This has to be. Now, is it Longchenpa? No. This is someone right now. Couldn't have understood. How could he understand these times so perfectly? I don't know. But he certainly does. He talks about how when those who love implosion come into this world, the world turns away from the Dharma, and then you have to retreat, he says. You retreat to the wild woods, so to speak, away from the turmoil of the cities, the non-dharmic attitudes of the cities, really meaning the places of where implosion is, you know, the heart centers of implosion and all these areas like that. But it's really global, wherever you go, especially in California, but all over the world. It's this way, actually. I talk to people who travel all the world. They say it's the same everywhere. It's the same everywhere. It's a global situation right now. Many people have told me, you're not going to find, if you think you're going to find the old ways anywhere, the old attitudes, you're not going to find them. It's this modernism is everywhere now in the world, everywhere. Especially among the younger generations, right? And but the older generations have really lost, you know, fumbled the ball away. Not surprisingly so. I mean, trying to retain a strong dharmic focus right now, you know, is quite difficult. But we can do it by this flattening practice, singularity practice. Sure, I have a position. It's wow. And they say, well, you can't abide if you have a position. Well, my abidance is wow, and my non-abidance is wow. And whatever I'm experiencing is wow. I'm experiencing wow, is what I'm experiencing. So many little bugs are flying over the place. black umbrella is the first thing I saw on the free umbrella. I said, uh-oh, I don't like the symbol of that black umbrella. What happens, black umbrella, suddenly pops open, right? Umbrellas pop open quickly and spread out. And they block out the sun, really. I mean, it's dark. They say they block out the rain, ideally, right? But darkness, you know, the black umbrella, darkness, in the symbol of umbrella is you hit a button and suddenly it pops open super fast, right? Like that. Suddenly the darkness is spread out over all of us. That was the first thing I saw, that turnover of a car. I said, uh-oh, I don't like that symbol right there. This something's wrong. If people ask, well, what is Longchenpa like? Longchenpa is wow. Refuse to take a position other than wow. Take this flat position. Now, if you see, don't take no position, because that in itself, the clever people love that. The ego loves that. It'll have a field day with you. So what you do is say, no, I'm an idiot. I'm not spiritual at all. They say, oh, you're so spiritual. You don't have a position. That's great. Let's look at this. Say, no, I have a position. Absolutely, I do have a position. I have a definition also. It's wow. Well, you know, defining, that's the ego. The ego loves to define, and you're defining, so you must be the ego. I say, well, the ego is wow. My definition is wow. This is wow, and that is wow, the ego's wow, the Holy Spirit's wow. Well, that's really, you know, that's not, I don't know what you're talking about. You know? Well, that's wow as well. My talking is wow, and my non-talking is wow. My clarity is wow, and my confusion is wow. My clarity is wow, and my confusion is wow. And the ego then says, I don't get it. You know, not getting it is wow. Absolutely. It's wow. Am I getting it as well? Am I not getting it as well? Am I getting it as well? Am I not getting it as well? This is flattening your position. So have a position, but have this super flat position right now. Do not stand up as somebody who's enlightened with no position at all. Okay, this has been stressed to me very severely. Instead, just be like this novice who just practicing. I'm a novice practicing the singularity practice. I'm very much a novice at it, and so I need to really practice it a lot in order to, you know, ultimately get better than a novice. I don't want to stay a novice forever. So, but I really have to keep practicing this, right? These those who love to implode, they love to tease a structure out of you so they can implode it. Okay, they love to tease a structure out of you so they can implode it. Some of those who've taken clever positions seem to have done that in the non-dual field, where they will sort of, you talk with them, and the way they do it is they put you in a situation where you end up having to build up a position, and then they implode it by their cleverness of you know, no position kind of thing, you just got imploded. But that's still the love of implosion here. We're not trying to do that. We do have a position, which is wow. We do have a definition, which is wow. We do have whatever anyone says we have, but it's wow. So we're not trying to trick anybody into building up some position to implode. We are stating from the very beginning, you know, we're not trying to get rid of anything in particular. We're just saying that everything is wow. It's not a spirit of imploding here, okay? It's not that, like that. So I didn't go to those non-dual teachers. I didn't like it. I said, something's not quite right here. I just don't like the way they were going. Some of them. There's a great variety, you know. There's a great variety. But I just felt in general, I felt like the focus wasn't quite, you know, what I wanted in terms of how I saw it, and I feel. So, you get the picture. The picture is wow, right? The picture is wow. Sure, I get the picture. The picture is wow. I see the wow. If you go to that into that situation, you say, you're talking, I say, well, I feel this way. What do you mean I? What's that I? You know, well, you said, you know, responding. Well, you know, well, you know, and so they kind of make you feel that you've got this structure. Then they're gonna, you know, implode it for you or something. But really, you know, that's kind of a game like that. It's we're not, because the I is wow. Sure, I have I. I am wow. I am wow. Not trying to get rid of the eye. I am wow. Now when the eye disappears, we say, well, the eye is wow. Where is gone? Well, no, the eye is wow, but it's not around. Well, it's in wow. It's in wow land. Where did it go? It's in wow land. It went to wow land. When's it coming back? Wow is when it's coming back. The eye is coming back. Wow is when the eye is coming back. So I am wow. And I being gone as well, and I disappearing as well, without disappearing without a trace as well. And where did I go? Disappear without a trace. It went to wow, wow land. You say, where's wow land? Wow land is in wow land. Wow land is in the great wow. Where's the great wow? The great wow is wow. You like that, but be careful of using any adjectives. That might get you in trouble. So, where did I disappear to? Disappeared into wow. And where is this wow? This wow is in wow. So try to avoid any compounding, because then the ego start start working with that. You know, try to keep it a singularity. So if you say, wow, land, you know, then that's sort of a compound. So that the I just disappeared into wow. Where did it go? You were away. It went to wow. Where is wow? Wow is in wow. What's it doing there? It's wowing. It's wowing wow. Well, how's it doing that? Because it's wow. I am wow. I am wow, that's why. I am wow. Is it happy? It's wow. Is it coming back? It's wow. Its return is wow. Its absence is wow. Its presence is wow. The presence of I is wow. The absence of I is wow. The presence is where? It's in wow. The absence of I is where? It's in wow. You see how we're flattening out the whole landscape here. The psychic, the egoic landscape, flattening it out like this. Little bugs jumping everywhere. It's a buggy thing. Wow. And so like these little questions of the ego bugging us, just use our breath, like that. The wow just they easily go. Divine breeze. Of wow. Now you might say, well, the world won't think me clever. Well, the world is wow. Cleverness is wow. Non-cleverness is wow. No world is wow. And cleverness will say, well, that's very clever. Now, you know, how did you think of that? Wow thought of it. When did you do it? I did it in wow. How did you come across this? Wow. Came across it. I am wow. Wow came across it. And so the cleverness will try to get you to say you're important. You know, you need to, how did this happen? This is interesting. It's very clever what you're doing. Very clever. So they want to discover the cleverness there. What they're saying is, how can I make something clever out of this instead of practice it? Right? You know that approach. The clever mind will say, well, how can I make something clever out of what you're doing? It seems really, really super clever. Amazingly clever. So how do I make something clever out of this without ever actually practicing it? Because that thing feels too dangerous to me. Too dangerous to the ego. Yeah. Well, the ego's wow. And the practice is wow. And the cleverness is wow. And the non-cleverness is wow. And the non-practice is wow. And the non-ego is wow. Yes, indeed. Wow. Wow, indeed. Yes is wow, and no is wow. Yes is wow, and no is wow. Both is wow, and neither is wow. Longchenpa is wow, and no Longchenpa is wow. Oops. I made a mistake there, the bug. I rubbed it, used my finger to get rid of it, and it crushed it. Sorry, bug. Use the wow to get rid of it, not the physicality, okay? That little bug was showing me something there. I wasn't mindful enough there. I said, something, feel something, what is that? I sort of put my finger, like when something's on your hand, you try to move your thumb automatically, say, what's that? And then suddenly it was a little bug. I realized, oh my gosh. I have to be more mindful, like that. So we'll make mistakes, right? We'll make mistakes with our mindfulness. We're trained to make mistakes in this world. So mistakes are wow. The bug is wow. That was just a little implosion there, wasn't it? Of the bug. The bug said, implode me, implode me. It was begging for implosion, that bug. That is for sure. Landing on the side of your thumb like that, when I have my thumbs like this, it's just, it's sort of like, well, there's an itch. The automatic, you on your right there, you're just gonna move your thumb just a little bit like this. What is that little itch? Just to see what it is. You're not sure what it is. It's just a reaction. So that bug was pleading for implosion. It's really spirit for pleading for implosion right there, and said, "You see, you love implosion. Well, a tiny bit, you might, a tiny bit, right? But the implosion is wow. My feeling about implosion is wow. My non-feeling about it is wow. Implosion is wow, and non-implosion is wow." But I tend to be very careful not to implode anything. So for me, that was like a big mistake. There's this tiny little ephemeral bug there. Landed on my thumb. But realistically in this world, we're not trying to take a position that we're totally free of the desire for implosion, because this is rooted in the fundamental fear that we have, okay? And so we're not completely free of fear yet. And of course we say, what are we? We're wow. We're not claiming, we just claim wow is what we claim. So we're not claiming enlightenment. We're claiming wow. We're claiming wow. Now maybe there's a few of you that will actually do this. You know, that's amazing, right? You never know. You never know. There might be someone, suddenly their resolve gathers. It's the opportune moment, the gathering of resolve. And they just say, hey, this is what I'm here for. I was reading an article on Ernie Els, the great golfer. I didn't realize how good he's really been, his career. And he said, my purpose here in life, I came to this planet to play golf. I know that's my purpose, and that's what he's done. He was in the top 10 for 783 weeks, consecutive weeks, the longest run in history, Ernie Els, in the top 10, ranked in the top 10 for 783 weeks. I mean, how long is that? That's a long, long time, isn't it? 700. That's like, 14 and plus years, right? Consecutively in the top 10 in the world. That is really extraordinary. And he was the guy before Tiger Woods showed up. Ernie Els was the next big thing. And he talked about it in this article. He says, it really shocked me and took me by, and no matter how good I did, every question I got was about Tiger, he said. I said, look, I'm in second place here. I'm playing great. I'm leading the tournament. And all you want to talk about is Tiger? He said, yeah, yeah. He said it was very difficult for him to deal with that. It was very difficult, very sort of annoying. But 70 world victories worldwide, 70 victories, 4 majors. He has a lot of tremendous streaks, I think, that are, second only to a couple of players. So he's one of the, greatest players of all time, Ernie Els. But he just said, my purpose was to come here and play golf. Okay. But our purpose here is wow. So there might be some whose purpose is to practice singularity. I came here to practice singularity. That's why I came here. Part of it, right? And nobody understood that. I couldn't explain it to anyone. How do you explain it? You have to practice it. You can't explain it. Because that goes into cleverness then. Because all the clever want to hear is a clever explanation. But I came to practice the wow, not explain it so much. I've been trying to explain it for years, but ultimately we're here to do it, to practice it. And another bug landed. I'm not going to implode you. Off you go. So nobody, you know, seems to get that here. They all think, well, you're here to be clever in some way. I said, it sounds really clever. Not really sure how, what kind of cleverness it is, but we hope good luck with your cleverness, you know. I say, no, it's not clever. Well, it has to be clever. I mean, that's what everyone does here. I said, no, not everyone. Some come to actually practice singularity. They're tired of cleverness. I'm really tired of cleverness, you know, really. Ah. I'm burned out on cleverness. Being a composer for the previous life, and I just couldn't be clever enough. You know, people praised my work as they, you know, I always wonder why did so many people love me as a composer. I'm one of the most beloved composers in history, in previous life, because I was so clever. They loved the cleverness of it and how I imploded everything. You know, I would build up structure, then I'd implode it. Very clever ways. Not in a modernistic way. I was more civilized than that. I had sort of like a civilized cleverness in my music. My music is not beautiful. I don't like listening to it at all this lifetime. Massive number of recordings of it. And I really don't listen to it at all. I think it's terrible. I said, who wrote that junk? You know, I said, that was me. Like, what was I thinking? That's terrible. but it's because the cleverness of implosion there in the music structure, the ways that I just continually built up different structures and then imploded them and then built up different ones. And the people just thought, wow, you're so brilliant. You're so clever. And Arthur Rubinstein said I was his favorite composer to play. I said, what are you talking about? You're the genius, you're the ultimate player of Chopin, and you rather prefer playing my music? I said, you must be stupid. But now I see this because he loved the cleverness of the music, the clever implosions like that. So I found out that even the most clever implosions are not the answer at all. I found myself coming back to this world. I said, holy cow, I'm through with that. It's not about cleverness anymore, is it? It's not about cleverness anymore. So I was very clever, but in a very civilized kind of way, right? You could say very egoically sophisticated in really sophisticated implosions through music. So I said, I want to get away from that cleverness. So I fell into the trap of rock and roll, which is not so clever, is it? And it was, for me, it was like a wonderful relief from all this extremely technical cleverness I did, both with orchestras and all different musical formats of classical music. How I was able to be creative and think up so many, many different ways to work this implosion motif into everything of, you know, all the counterpoint in so many different ways about doing it. I just was happy just to play the blues here, you know, just like my baby left me, da, 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 right to the heart of the point. She imploded me, right? Like my baby imploded me. She left with another. I'm imploded. Simple implosion, you know, simple emotional implosion. You know, it's like, oh, what a relief from having to toil, you know, just ceaselessly trying to come up with more and more and more clever implosions for the audience who was thirsty, you know, for more and more clever implosions in the music. But they love the music because of that cleverness. And I'm done with cleverness, so I don't love the music at all anymore. I don't love my own music at all. Hitler didn't love it either. He hated it because he wanted more direct, brutal implosions. He said, this stuff is, it's too clever. And I don't like that level of cleverness. It's too civilized. It's too civilized. He doesn't really want to tear down civilization. He just wants to keep it going with some, you know, sophisticated type of implosion, musical implosion, that kind of thing. But he wants to keep it going. But, you know, so Hitler hated it. He said, no, I that's the wrong style for me. He says, we want to really directly, brutally implode this, you know, severely implode it. So I was like his you know, he hated my music. He wanted to ban it, but he couldn't because so many people loved it. And maybe it in some way, you know, minimized, lessened the troubles of World War II, World War I and II. I don't know. Maybe not. But it was sort of saying, like, let's go gentle on civilization. Let's not, you know, get too gung-ho on imploding it. Maybe we can divert our desires to implode it brutally by sitting at a piano and imploding on your piano, and that should be enough. So I was really trying to get people to play piano, to get involved with music, and to let their creativity play out on the piano. So I was very good. I could build stuff up on the piano and implode it, you know, amazingly, beautifully. But I said, for the rest of it, you know, let's see if we can, you know, be very civilized with one another. So it might have been a way of to try and channel us towards moving towards a more dharmic culture by, you know, let's play out this implosion. Let's make it less than we used to make it. Let's keep civilization going here. And the implosions were not really death implosions on the piano. It was more like we build it up and we go down, but we don't go down too far, you know. And we can build it back up, and let's take a look at this, you know. Let's take a look at what we're doing through this music. So there's something there, dharmic there, you know. There's something there of, like, let's be aware. What are we doing in civilization? Can we look at it musically in a beautiful format like that, in a very civilized way? And so anyway, it was like that. But I got tired of the cleverness, you know, really tired of it. It doesn't satisfy at all. There's many composers, their lives are miserable, you know, because they're trying to find some good in the ego. You know, I was trying to find some good in the ego. Like the ego, I said, the ego, yeah, I felt like we need it, but can we make it beautiful? Can we somehow make it beautiful and gentle and less, you know, less terrible? Apparently not, right? Yeah. I was very shocked when I came reincarnated here, came back in World War II. I found out about the particulars of it, and I was just devastated by it, absolutely devastated. I said, that's what I was trying to avoid that, you know, avoid it. And look what happened to the German people. I was so distraught about it. Look what they did. Look how they turned, you know, that way, back to their old pagan ways, you know. I was trying to enculturate Europe out of that, and obviously, you know, failed. It's like, wow, what a shocker. And so I realized that, you know, it didn't work. It didn't work. So I have to find something better than that. But maybe it helped in some, globally, in some way, people that listen to my music tend to be introspective and not so into trying to combat externally anyone. They're kind of looking at the ego, looking at that, and say, what's going on here? And they develop sort of an introspective habit, but they also can become depressed in some way, trying to, again, find the root of trying to believe that the ego has, you know, is somehow we have to make it right, you know, make it right, instead of realizing it's never been here at all. So it was dualistic. It was trying to make dualism somehow work, which it doesn't work, actually. It doesn't work at all. So classical music was this big attempt, and it didn't work. It didn't work. Still not working, actually. It's still not working. It never will work, actually. So I put so much into classical music, trying to build it up as maybe this is a hope, you know, for half a millennium, you could say, that the great hope was classical music, actually, for a long time, high culture. And so, you know, half a millennium probably of involvement with classical music, all for naught, you know. It was a very, you know, bitter pill to swallow. I couldn't have been so talented at it if I didn't have a lot of involvement in it through numbers of lives, actually. So I came into the previous life already like a prodigy. So I had to have a lot of involvement with trying to build musical culture up. And to see that it failed, you know, was just like devastating for me. Devastating. Okay, when I found out about World War II and one, but mostly two, was just, it was what the, you know, what happened, took place, was just, I was utterly devastated by it psychologically, and saying, "Wow, Europe, how could you do that?" We poured my heart and soul into Europe, and trying to raise the culture up, and so many of us did that, and to see what it went through like that was just unbelievable tragedy. So I realized, you know, music isn't it, especially, you know, all this. So I had to decompress from it through rock and roll, blues, various different simple, real simple, basic, primitive types of music. I couldn't get free of music directly. I had to kind of unwind from it through simplicity, and ultimately I got free of it. People might think, oh, you know, he has simple musical tastes. He's listening to this real simple pop stuff or Dion or, you know, whatever. But for me, that's a way to get free of the vast complexity I was involved with. Without, you know, jettisoning music entirely right off the bat. It's too difficult to do that right off the bat. It's really difficult. People have severe addictions to music. It's really difficult. So I just went into simpler and simpler and simpler and simpler stuff. Try to stick with that and avoid the complex stuff. Of course, the Beach Boys caught me by their complexity. And I said, oh, it sounds simple, but it's complex. Maybe that's the answer. I thought maybe they had found the answer. Of course, we know how that turned out with, you know, look at Brian Wilson and his frustrations with life. You know, you talk about a tortured musician. Look at Brian Wilson, one of the greatest musical geniuses in the history of the world, without question. Without question, he was able to make complexity seems simple, and that was his effort, and of course that didn't work either. And he's this very odd person, you know, very kind of tormented. He was extremely tormented in life, Brian Wilson, just epically tormented, you know, with all the attempts he's made to get well and psychological help and everything. He keeps thinking that music's the answer. You know, if he did singularity practice, it would be a different story, wouldn't it? It would. Because I'm not tormented. I used to be like tormented like that. Maybe even worse, though. I went to the very bottom of torment. But music will really take you into torment, because you really have so much hope for it, and you realize it doesn't work, but you just can't admit it to yourself. You know, it seems like if music doesn't work, what does? You know, there's nothing works, that kind of thing. Well, singularity practice works. The Dharma works. Wow works, actually. We would say wow is wow, to practice it. So I'm not a tormented soul anymore. I was like Brian Wilson. I really was. I was completely withdrawn at the very bottom of depression and just despondency. And the grace of God saved me. Of course, and miracles really started it powerfully. But the grace of God was active in me, really saying, you know what? I came in to overcome all this stuff here and get to the singularity practice. What does work? You know, I know that music doesn't work, but the Beach Boys hooked me. They said, oh, maybe it does work. You know, I got like that. Because he was so clever at it. There's this group called the Fender Tones who reproduce live the Beach Boys songs, and they do a fabulous job of it, but it's so difficult and so complex, and they're still not as good, you know, but just, they say it is so, so difficult, that there's so much hidden layers of complexity in the Beach Boys music, and there certainly is. It's But it all sounds, on the surface, it all sounds so poppy and simple, you know. But they say, well, where is he getting these sounds? But there's all this different stuff going on in the deep stuff. And it's just like, good Lord, you know, good Lord. He was a super genius and did his very best to try and bring happiness to the ego. And you know, a lot of people went down that road with him, you know, Beach Boy fans. I certainly did. And when he, you know, crashed and burned, imploded, you know, I imploded. I sort of, it was just the whole time's imploded. So wait a minute, you know, this didn't work. And here come the Beatles, you know, with their jingly jangly stuff and their directly imploding stuff strongly. And like, wait a minute, we had this, we thought we were going to make the ego beautiful. And it's now looking ugly to us, you know. Oh my gosh, what happened? For a while there, with, you know, the ego was looking pretty beautiful. The California sound in the early 60s with you know, the surf and the sun and the toy companies out here. And it was just, we were riding this wave of super optimism here in the West Coast in the late 50s, early 60s. And that's when I was, you know, young. And, you know, you cannot hardly understand the optimism we have. We had the most beautiful area in the world. Freedom to travel everywhere throughout the state. Everything was cheap, and we're just snapping pictures and going surfing, and everyone looked tan and healthy and beautiful, and new toys are coming out all the time. Hula hoop, skateboard, you know, the surf thing was going crazy. And then here come the Beach Boys music on the car radio. Early 60s radio was unbelievable with Dion and the Beach Boys and everyone else, you know, Elvis, and good Lord, it was like a golden age. And we were thinking, you know what, the ego can be beautiful. Maybe I think we found the way here in California. And so later the 60s happened, and all the turmoil and ugliness and implosion came in, you know, I was devastated. I lost my world. You know, I lost that feeling that maybe the ego can be beautiful. And I didn't have anywhere else to go, really, except at the back of my mind, I knew that there's this great book that was going to come into the world, this great teaching through a book or books. And I knew that was going to come in and save me. So that's the only thing that saved me. If I hadn't have known that, there's no way I could have been saved. It would have been suicide, for sure. But I knew that was going to happen. And then when I found that in a bookstore, it struck me, says, this is it. I was so shocked by it. It took me a month before I went back and actually bought it. I was so stunned. I said, oh my God, I found it. And this is going to totally change my life. I knew it. I said, if I get this book, it is going to absolutely change my life forever. I'll never be the same. And it took me a month to get the courage to do it, gather my resolve to do it. Bunch of nightmares saying, if you don't do this, you're ruined, you know. I knew it. So I finally went back and bought it with all the money I had left in the world. And then I knew that was it. This is going to completely change my life forever. And that's exactly what happened. It was A Course in Miracles by Jesus Christ. Jesus the Christ. Jesus who's realized that, you know, none of us are ever unawake. The unawakeness is impossible. So we're all perfectly equal in the oneness, the one mind. The Christ mind, as he calls it. The one mind. So we can be really down and despondent, but in the back of our mind, we might know there's something going to come along to help us. And so you got to have trust in your intuition, which is what I did. And I even told people, I said, when I was younger, I said, look, all your teachings are, you know, very clever, and some of them are good, better than others and all this, but there's going to be a teaching coming that I'm going to be involved with, which is really, really high, very high powered, extremely high quality, and that's A Course in Miracles. And extensions of that, Journey Beyond Words, The Other Voice, Dialogue on Awakening, and maybe, you know, whatever else there is out there. But very high-powered. And I told people about it, and I knew it was coming. And they said, well, maybe it's this book? And everyone would show me books. Is it this one? You know, look at this book. I've got this book. You know, they tried to say, this is it, right? This is what you're talking about. I said, no. I'd read the book. I read so many books when I was young because everybody thought they had the book that I was talking about. So you're talking about this one, you know, Krishnamurti, yes, this and this. So I read massive amounts of books. I'd read and I'd say, that's good, but that's not the one. It's not the one. It's not the one. It's not the one. A little insect crawling. Got it. Didn't try to see. What is that? So I was incredibly well read because everyone had this feeling like, we've got the book, you know. So we know what's... And I said, no, that's not it. And then, of course, in miracles, boom, this is it. Funny thing is that none of the people that gave me all these books, none of them ever read A Course in Miracles. They thought they already had the book. Why? Their cleverness. They had a book that, to them, resonated with cleverness. Whereas A Course in Miracles doesn't really resonate with cleverness at all. And so they're really not interested in it. Just a little curious. Yeah, I'm curious enough. I see some clever, maybe there's some cleverness there, but not really enough for me, you know. Like that. And then Journey Beyond Words, wow. That was a shocker too. I said, there's got to be some extension of this. I said, I know there's got to be. It's going to happen. And one day I walked in a bookstore and I found that. I said, oh my gosh, here it is. And that one really, really was shocking, shockingly devoid of cleverness, you know, wow. Jesus is shockingly devoid of cleverness, and he's willing to really teach that way, you know, it's like, wow, amazing. Yeah, the Dharma kings are shockingly devoid of cleverness. No matter what we do, we can't trap them into that cleverness. They just are not wired that way at all anymore. They're just not wired that way at all. They just can't go there. You know, they just don't go there. And we're wondering, how come they didn't go there? I teed it up for them, you know. I teed it high and, you know, let it fly. Come on, take a whack at it. See how clever you can be. You can probably be super clever. No, they never bite. They never bite. Yeah, and so that's shocking to us, too. It, no matter how I tee up Jesus, he never bites. Just tee it low, tee it low, tee it real low. I'll take a hybrid off the tee. I was talking to someone about golf today. The one's going to golf in Tahoe at Edgewood, and he said, oh, yeah, I'm just going to go and just smash it all over the place. I said, really? Is that how you play? He said, no, not really. I'm very conservative. He says, I just keep it in the middle of the fairway. Keep it in the short grass. That's what it's all about. I say, well, what do you tee off? He says, I hit a 4-iron. I said, I hit a 4-iron like 200 plus, and I'm good. That's all I need. He says, unless it's really wide open, then I'll hit a driver. But it has to be really wide open. And I say, that's really smart. You're really, really smart to do that. Very wise. That's what I'm trying to get to. Keep it in the short grass. Keep it in the fairway. Keep it in the low grass. Okay? Be meek. You know, he just hits a 4-iron, for goodness sakes. That's the way to really play if you're wise. Unless you're a pro. Yeah. And not many of us are. Oh, I know what else has. Else has this third highest top 10 finish percentage, top 10% in majors. Tiger Woods is number one, Phil Mickelson is number two, Ernie Els is number three, and how they finished in majors over that long, over his career. So that's pretty amazing statistic, isn't it? To show massive consistency in the major golf tournaments, that means you're really, really good. But keep it in the short grass, the low grass. Tee off with that. I gotta practice. My hybrid, though, doesn't have a... Maybe I can, The shaft is too flexible, son of a gun. Maybe I'll have to order another shaft for that one, too. A new shaft. Keep it low. Keep it low. Well, keep it in the low grass, for sure. Don't go wandering off in the deep stuff, the high grass. Then the ego's going to get you. So, again, Longchenpa is wow, isn't he? He's really wow. Just wow. So stick with this wow. right now. Convey the super, gather your resolve and just do it. Gather your resolve and just do it. It's really that simple. And, you know, just trust in the Dharma Kings, which is really just the compassion of God. The grace of God is really the compassion of God. Longchenpa says that's a normal attribute of reality. It just spontaneously, instantly happens. So put your trust in that. It's either that or you put your trust in beautifying the ego, trying to make the ego look good. Don't ever put your trust in that. Don't ever put your trust in that. You will certainly come to regret that, as I did, to the most severe extent, because I put so much effort and faith into it. I said cleverness, you know, just really, really benign, kind cleverness, you know, maybe we'll do it. Didn't do it. And certainly crude cleverness won't do it, right? Hitler didn't do it, did he? Ruthless cleverness won't do it. Brutal cleverness won't do it. No cleverness will do it. Earnestness will do it. Genuine earnestness to gather your resolve and practice, the singularity practice. That will do it. Longchenpa believes it will do it. He told me it will do it. He says, you're going to succeed for sure. I can tell. I can see your resolve. I know you'll gather it. You know, it's going to work. It works. It will work. So I have faith singularity practice will work for me. Just like I had faith that I'd find that book, Course in Miracles. I know that book is there. It's going to be Jesus promised, you know, the one mind promised. So I know singularity practice. I have faith in singularity practice. I don't know. I have faith that it will work. I have enough faith to gather my resolve like this. And along with the help of the Dharma Kings, we will keep our faith in that and keep practicing it. Keep in mind the lineage of Longchenpa, you might call Pabasava Longchenpa, the Nyingma lineage, the ancient tradition. It's always been generally a non-monastic tradition, a householder, layperson tradition. So you don't have to be in a monastery, to do this. And you could be married. You can have a, you know, committed relationship, spouse. Many throughout history have done just that. So, it's been a super successful lineage throughout history. There's something about monasticism that can develop a sense of cleverness also, right? Yeah, if you're not careful. Sometimes the difficulties of just a regular life are such that it's even more helpful in some ways. Can be. I mean, monasticism can also be very successful if you use it in the right way. But having just a regular life and working, you know, I mean, work is so difficult and stressful and dangerous and life is so difficult and struggling with everything that a householder would struggle with, you know. And nothing is the way it should be, right? So this helps me focus and really drives me to practice a lot. So don't think you have to be some special, important spiritual person in some retreat, in some monastery in the Himalayas or something, right? Just be simple. Just be earnest. Wherever you are, just be earnest enough to gather your resolve to practice singularity practice. Just do that. Do just that. And Nyingma traditions had tremendous success through out almost, you know, maybe what you used to call it 1300 years, 1400 years. Tremendous, tremendous success. A gloriously successful tradition that Padmasambhava, you might say, started the Nyingma tradition. You could trace Dzogchen back a lot further than that, actually. Right? The Dzogchen tradition, the Nyingma tradition, a super glorious tradition, actually. So we're being helped by that glorious tradition, and we're being helped because we're practicing the singularity practice, and they know that's what works. And they're not looking at us to say, well, what, you know, what monastery are you part of, or what kind of renunciate are you necessarily, or what's this or this. They're only looking at your resolve and your earnestness, your willingness to gather that in practice. That's all. That's how they see us, like that. You don't have to be Tibetan to be part of the Nyingma tradition or Dzogchen tradition. You don't have to be in any geographical location or any particular specialness about you, or of racial heritage or gender, anything like that. You just have to be truly earnest enough to gather your resolve to practice the singularity practice. That's it. Then you're part of the solution instead of being part of the problem. So don't shortchange yourself thinking, well, I'm not good enough because I live a householder existence, you know, pestered by all these situations and stuff. I was just in a cave somewhere, I could do it. Don't think that way. That's a mistake. Because I'm being pestered by every kind of situation here. I live in this belly of the beast here in Silicon Valley. Are you kidding me? I'm in a very non-dharmic place, but I've made this just this little area here for my dharma practice, you see, my singularity practice. And nothing has disturbed it. Nothing has disturbed it because it's so modest and humble and simple and just, I never said what I'm doing. I never explained to anybody. No one's ever asked. I've never explained to anybody what I'm doing. My wife, I just said, you know, I'm taping. You know, I'm just taping. She goes, okay. I like doing it. She says, okay, that's your hobby. That's what you do. Great. Not a problem. Go ahead and tape. Does anyone I know watch the videos? No, nobody I know watches the videos. I never told anybody that I'm making any videos. No one in my social family relationship. Nobody even knows I've made any videos at all or done anything in my life. Actually, so you see, you know, you don't have to get the approval of others to do it. You just do it. You just do it. Don't try to explain to anyone else what you're doing. You can't explain singularity practice. Everybody's looking for a clever explanation, and you say, "Oh, you're a clever person. Great. You're like me. I want clever." Just do it. You're too simple for that. Just my life is wow. What I'm doing is wow. Wow is the result. Wow is the non-result. Wow is the result, and wow is the non-result. The result is wow, the non-result is wow. Okay? Like that. So keep your focus in the fairway, as we would say. And golf, keep your focus in the fairway, singularity practice. Don't go wandering off into the bushes, into the trouble, into all that complexity. Wow. wow, bug is just jumping all over the place behind me. So my path is wow. My life is wow. My effort is wow. My practice is wow. My commitment is wow. My purpose is wow. All is wow. Even not wow is wow. Not wow is wow. Okay, not wow is wow. Not wow is wow. So just gather resolve, be conservative, just keep on advancing, okay? Keep on advancing. Someone told me about a par 5. They said, if you play with a 7 iron, 3 shots and you're on. Easy. And the other right. You hit your 7 iron a fairly long way. 170, 240, 340, rather. 340 yards, and then hit it another 170. About 510. 510. Par 5, let's say it's a 500-yard par 5. Hits 3 7 irons, you're on the green. How is that any different than someone crushing a driver, crushing a three wood, and then hitting a pitching wedge on the green? It's the same. You're still on in 3 shots, okay? And then you 2-putt for par. You're fine. Just use 7 iron. Whereas if you hit the driver, you could easily go out of bounds, go you know, lose your ball, go into trouble, hit your 3 wood, same thing. Might squirt too much right on you, go into trouble. And you might get on the green in 4 or 5, you know, struggling that way. Trying to be a hero, trying to do too much. So if you just take the conservative approach, it's pretty hard to hit your 7-iron out of bounds, actually. So 7-iron, 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 you're on the green. Now, that's not a glamorous way to play. Okay, but do we really want to be glamorous these days? Do we really want to implode? Keep in mind, again, implosion is what this world's all about. It was what we, those who come to this world is here because they love implosion. Okay, they love implosion. They think it's their salvation. So that's why history is the way it's been here in this world. Okay, and looks like it's going to continue that way here for now. So keep that in mind as you say, let's just play conservatively, conservatively, conservatively. Occasionally, pull out the driver if it's warranted. Yeah, I pulled it out on the 18th hole last time, and I hit 2 balls. And it was both really good shots, really really great. So, I feel okay because it opened it. It is warranted somehow. The whole I felt like this will play to the driver, but again, implosion. We turn away from that through singularity practice. Okay, turn away from it through singularity practice. So the new way is wow. The new way is wow. The new way is wow.